Hey there, it's Steve with the Auto Station. You know what? One of the questions I get a lot is, can I use a different grade oil in my car than the one I've been using? Can I use a different grade than the one that it says up on that little placard under the hood? And the answer is yes, you can, but it's complicated. And you really need to hear what I have to say before you make a choice to jump into this oil versus that oil. Most of the times people are asking me because they're trying to extend the life of their motor. They're trying to make it longer, last longer, and let's face it, you make your car last longer, you really cut down on your cost of driving. I mean, if you go out and get a different car, you buy a used car, you go out and get the best car you can ever find. But if you can make the one that you own last a couple years longer than it ordinarily would, that's how you really save a few bucks. The reason the manufacturers these days are going to thinner and thinner oil is 100% to do with fuel efficiency and fuel economy and environmental concerns. So there's a lot of pressure on everybody to get cleaner air, all that kind of great stuff. We've got climate issues on the go. So the idea is to burn less gas in the first place. And that's what this stuff's about. We're trying to get the car to have less friction. Huge increase in our fuel efficiency, fuel economy. Miles per gallon, kilometers or liters per 100 are going down, mileage is going up. Using these type of thinner oils, that's why we're going with them. The problem is it's great for everything except for the motor. We're going to thinner and thinner oils, which means more and more internal wear on these things. So the questions that we're getting is like, is there anything else I can do? I don't want to put this thin stuff inside my motor. I want my motor to run well, and I want it to run well for a long period of time. So what is it can I do? Can I go into a 1030 here? Can I go to a 530? Is there something else I can do? And I think that we have to understand what it is this oil grade is telling us, and then we can make some minor modifications. So the first thing to understand is what these oils are. And basically the first number here, the way this nomenclature goes is that's a zero winter dash 16 oil. In this case here, we're looking at a 5 winter dash 40. We got a 10W60, in this case here, 10 winter dash 60. So what that means is there's this SAE, there's a Society of Automotive Engineers, have come up with a rating system. So this is not 3 or 4 or 5 different kinds of oil all mixed together in the same jug. This is the rating that we've got across this testing spectrum. So the test begins at -17.8 degrees Celsius, I believe it is, and they measure the flow. They pour this stuff at that temperature into this thing called a viscometer. It flows through and they measure how quickly it runs, how much runs over a certain amount of time, and they get a number. In this case here, it's running pretty thin, close to water almost actually, but it's running thin enough to be designated as a zero. The second half of the test is they take the stuff and they heat it up to 100 degrees, pour it through the same measuring device, and they measure how much goes through, how much volume, how much time it takes to get the certain quantity through, and that comes up with a number. In this case, it's 16. This is a heavier oil. In this case, it's 60. So less oil comes through, the thicker it is. So this has got a thicker oil versus this. Similar at low temperatures, ultra low temperatures. This one here is a 5, that's a 10. This one here is a, the colder the weather, the more oil it's gonna flow here. So what we're doing here, we wanna look at how does this engine lubricate. You look at it, one of the great examples that we use and we talk to everyone about, it's like a kid water ski. You put the water skis on your kid, you throw him over the side of the boat, he sinks down up to his neck and that's where he is. The water doesn't change, but now you start moving and you pull up on top of the water and the kid on the water skis, or the adult on the water skis for that matter, skims across the surface of the water. That's the same thing that happens with the oil. Once these things begin to spin, there's a velocity component to it. And we're getting up on top of the oil and the engine components, instead of metal on metal, we're up on top of the oil and we're skimming across the oil and there's no wear. So the thicker the oil, the more effective that film is, the less wear there is, and the less wear there is, the longer your car lasts. So those pistons are moving up and down inside the cylinder and you got all that stuff spinning and the oil is dripping down over top of the crankcase and connecting rods and all that kind of stuff. The thicker the oil, the more resistance it has, the more friction it has. So if you want to increase the fuel efficiency in your car, one of the best ways to do it, or the easiest ways to do it, is to use a thinner oil. So what these engine guys are doing is say, okay, how do we get 1% increase of efficiency in our fuel mileage, which is huge. In the automotive world, to get 1% better fuel economy in your car is a big, big difference. And if you can do that simply by going from an oil that's got the second number as a 30 down to a 20, pretty easy way to do it. Don't have to change anything. Don't have to get the engineering guys to come up with tighter tolerances, looser tolerances. Just go with a different oil, better fuel economy. So that's kind of where we're going with this. So as the automakers are looking for more and more efficient cars, they're looking for higher and higher fuel efficiencies, they're going to thinner and thinner oils. So if you look at it, we've got a zero base oil, real thin oil, and they're adding all kinds of modifiers and additive packages. So there's stuff for rust improvement, there's stuff for anti-foaming agents, there's all kinds of things. And one of them is a viscosity modifier. So if you look at this, here's my little prop here. We're looking at this as a viscosity modifier, just a piece of plastic that runs this thing. It's a hydrocarbon chain, hydrogen, carbon, but it reacts differently at temperature. So you take this thing inside an engine, nice and cold, start it up, you got this, it does nothing to increase the viscosity of the oil. It just runs through that little viscosity meter the same way, the same flow rate as the base oil. But as that oil begins to warm up, it begins to twist itself, it contorts itself, and it comes up into one of these little things. It twists, multi-purpose device here for prop purposes. It gets in here, and if you look at this at the microscopic level, down here, right in the oil, this thing here gets in, it disrupts the flow of oil. It's a two molecules of oil slipping over top of it. With these things in between, it makes it a little harder to move. It makes it a little thicker, is sort of generally what happens. That's the behavior pattern of the oil is now thicker than it would have been without these modifiers. So that's what they're doing. So when you're looking at where my oil is, really the number that we're looking at is the bottom number. And the second number has been something that's artificially modified to behave thicker. So the question we get, guys are coming in, I got a new Toyota. It's telling me I'm gonna be using this stuff over here, which is the 016. What would happen if I went to a 060? You know, the problem that we have is that these engines have been designed at a certain, you know, there's a preset calibration for the oil pump, for example, at this thickness, at this temperature, this is how much oil it's gonna pump. We've got bearing tolerances. We're to get in with the proper film, that little hydrodynamic wedge that forms. We have to have the oil of a certain viscosity to actually get in there and maintain that layer. So we get that sort of water skiing effect. So there is a limitation to how high you could go in a motor that comes down, and a lot of it is temperature. A lot of it is application. We've got pre-engineered considerations here. We look at bearing clearances. You know, if we got a 2 thou clearance in the bearing or we got a 3 thou clearance in the bearing, it makes a difference in how we lubricate it, and it makes a difference in what choice of product it is. And that's certainly the considerations that the manufacturer is going to have when they recommend this grade of oil versus that grade of oil. So yes, we can make some movements. Understanding what these numbers mean in terms of temperature, in terms of performance, is a big start in making some of these decisions. Personally, I find that, you know, I'm not going to mess with the lower number except to go lower, because if I'm using a 530, for example, and I know I'm going up to northern climates and it's going to be unbelievably cold, and if I'm going to set my oil up for that, I'm going to think about dropping to a lower number, because that's a reasonable choice. And if I'm heading down to the desert of the, you know, Death Valley or something, and I'm going to pull something heavy, and I'm thinking, wow, it's going to be hot there, moving above the upper number, that's something that you can consider as well. But you can't go the other way. You can't go from this number here where it's a low number and go to a slight, you can't go to a 1030 when it says 530. It's just something that's not gonna work. It's gonna cause huge problems. And you can't go the other way where you go from a 1030, say, down to a 1020. I mean, you need the thickness. You can't go lower. It's just a bit of a problem. So certain applications, the idea is to get an understanding of what it is the oil is doing, what it is we're trying to get it to do. Consider that all in your sort of overall cost. Consider that when it comes to, what are the maintenance impacts on me if I go from this oil to that oil, and if I stay right where the manufacturer is? What happens if I'm pulling a trailer, for example? So there are other considerations that have to be considered, but knowing what the oil product is where it starts. So generally speaking, the manufacturers sort of have us in this position where we have to use something close to the oil they're talking about. You know, we can't really go too crazy with it. We can make some product modifications or some choices, I think, that we can do to sort of enhance based on application only. But generally, you know, to use a car across the time period, in the winter, we need to really concentrate on this bottom number. And in the summer, we can, as long as the number goes up rather than down, we can do a few things there. So on the cars that come in specified at 016, really no problem going 020. There's really no problem with that whatsoever. Looking at the difference in the oil, it's just so small, it's not gonna make a difference. But if we jump up from 020 to 060, problems. So you can't make that big of a difference. But if you're looking for, you know, maximizing oil, you're, say, summer trip, you're gonna head down to the somewhere hot, you could drive down to Death Valley or something like that, you're gonna pull a heavy trailer, yes, you could go up on the second number, increase that by a few, maybe 10, go from a 020 to a 030, you could probably do that, and the motor will most likely perform better with that. But as a rule, the idea is we're kind of stuck, whatever the manufacturer's telling us, they'll put a label somewhere on the car. This is the specified oil, this is the recommended oil. We're pretty much stuck to using that. So yes, the oil's getting thinner and thinner, but it's being changed out. The whole viscosity thing, it's not really the oil itself that's changing, it's the additive package. So we talked a lot about oil today. You know what, I know it's a controversial subject, and I know that it's sort of, we're breaking the boundaries here, we're pushing things back. But there's all kinds of different technicians are out there. There's all kinds of guys that have got experience taking these motors down with this oil and that oil and having a look at what's happening with piston rings and having a look at what's happening at turbo bearings, all that kind of great stuff. What we're really looking to do here is to form a conversation point. If anyone's out there has got any experience, please put it in the comments. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to hear what you're doing in the winter with one oil versus another. We'd love to hear what you're doing with these new ultra-thin, ultra-low-weight oils that are being recommended by manufacturers. If you've got something, share it with us. I'm sure everyone would love to hear it. Steve at the Auto Station.